Today we are going to learn about targeted drug delivery system. First, we will try to see what is the reason behind targeting the delivery of the drug to a particular region in the body. So generally what happens when you take a tablet, generally what we do, we take a drug, we'll add an excipient, then we'll prepare a dosage form. Let's say the dosage form is tablet. When you give this tablet to the body, this tablet after disintegrating, it will dissolute, then the drug will be absorbed throughout the body. Okay, now let's say that you have pain in the hand, you have taken the tablet for the pain. Now the drug present in the tablet, when it get absorbed, it will move all over the body. So it will travel all over the body. Then when it reaches to your hand, then it will show its action. So this is good for tablets which are drugs which are not so much toxic. I am talking about painkiller here. Now let's change the scenario. The thing that the patient is suffering from cancer. Now all anti-cancer drugs are more toxic. Okay, they have more side effects. Now if you give that anti-cancer drug, or you expose normal cell to the concentration of anti-cancer drug, in that case the normal cell is also been destroyed by the anti-cancer drug, which we don't want to happen. We don't want that to happen. To avoid that, what we want is we need to target the anti-cancer drug direct to the region in the body where there is a problem like cancer. Let's say the patient is suffering from liver cancer. I want to direct my drug, okay, or I will design a dosage form in such a way that this dosage form will carry the drug directly to the region where there is a problem, that is in this case it is a cancer. The patient is having liver cancer, is suffering from the liver cancer. I want to direct this drug, or I want to target this drug to the liver, because there is cancer, I want the drug to be targeted to the liver. Now, by targeting the drug to the liver, what I am going to do here is, I am reducing the side effects. So by targeting the drug to the liver, what I am doing here, I am reducing the side effects, reducing the toxicity, increase the effectiveness of the drug. Okay, then reducing the dose, because in general what happens when you take tablet orally, the drug will undergo first pass metabolism, so some part of the drug will be destroyed in the liver. Due to that, you need to fill that gap. Okay, we are giving more dose of the drug. When you target the drug directly to the region where it is been showing its action, like by targeting, I am reducing the dose also. By reducing the dose, you can reduce the side effects, toxicity is reduced, and also by targeting, even the toxicity can be reduced more prominently compared to the reduction of the dose. So targeting a drug to the required part is a essential phenomena which we can make use for the effective treatment. Okay, for the effective treatment of particular problem, or you can say in this case it is a cancer. So these are the various advantages of drug targeting. Now we'll see what are the different methods of drug targeting, in how many methods you can target the drug. So first method is passive targeting. So passive targeting, the name itself suggests that you are not doing anything there, special thing to target the drug. You just give the drug in some dosage form. This dosage form will be carried out by the body phenomena. So generally body has some phenomena. So we are going to adjust the dosage form, or we are going to prepare the dosage form in such a way that this dosage form or generally carried out to a place where we need to target by the body itself. How and what we try to see here. In passive targeting, for example, some types of colloids, colloidal particles, or you can say lipids, lipid particles, the lipid dosage form. When you give, take a drug, coat the drug with the colloid or lipids. When you give this, inject this into the bloodstream. Now, convert this. See, what you have to do is take a drug, take a lipid particle, convert them into a nano, size reduce them into nano, then give them through a injection, inject them into the body. Now, after giving the injection, what happens? These nanoparticles or lipid nanoparticles will be roaming around the roaming with the help of blood circulation. Okay, so in our body there are two RES system, that is reticuloendothelial cell system. What are those system? Are one is spleen, other is liver. So generally what I said, passive targeting, you are not doing anything to the dosage form, you're just giving the dosage form, body will take up the dosage form to the particular site. So body is directing that. In this case, spleen and liver are organs which will try to take up colloidal particles especially, and lipid particles. If you coat the drug with colloidal particles and lipid particle, those particles in general are being concentrated in spleen and liver. Okay, so if the person is suffering from a spleen cancer or liver cancer, you can just convert your drug into colloidal and lipid particles into nano form, give to the patient. Your body itself will direct that dosage form to the spleen and liver, because these organs, reticuloendothelial cell organs, have an ability to catch up that colloidal and lipid particles. So you are not doing anything, body will direct them and they will be targeted here. So this is your passive targeting. Next, let's say I am giving same colloids and lipids. Now I don't want to target at spleen or liver, I want to target them in some other place. Because you are giving colloids and lipids, there is a chance that they will get accumulated in spleen and liver. I don't want that to happen. So then comes the second method, inverse targeting. So what we are going to do in this method is a simple. Because if you give the drugs in the form of colloidal lipid particles, there is a chance that this will get concentrated in the spleen or liver. In second method, I don't want them to concentrated in the spleen or liver, because I want to target some other organ. In that case, what you have to do is take colloids, don't put the drug into the colloid. Okay, here empty colloids, okay, shell colloids, empty colloids you need to inject into the body. Empty colloids, there is no drug, okay, only colloids. Prepare colloid, nanoparticle, without drug, inject them into the body in higher concentration. Now, because spleen and liver has an ability to concentrate them, these colloidal particles within them, this empty colloidal particles, these empty colloidal particles will get accumulated in the spleen and liver. Now, the spleen and liver is being saturated by empty colloids. Next, after giving the empty colloid, after some time, you start injecting the colloids with the drugs. Start injecting the colloids with the drug. Now, because previously you have injected empty colloids, these colloids are being concentrated on the spleen and liver. Those are being saturated by empty colloids. Now, these colloids will not take the colloid which has the drug, because they are already been saturated by colloidal particles. Hence, this colloidal drug particle, which is injected after injecting empty colloids into the body, can be directed to other parts, can be utilized to target other parts of the body. So this method we call it as a inverse targeting. The name suggests inverse because we are avoiding spleen and liver. That thing we are targeting in a passive targeting, but in inverse targeting, we are saturating spleen and liver with empty colloids. After the saturation, we are giving the colloids which is been saturated with the drug. So drug loaded colloids, this will be targeted, can be make use to target other organs in the body. This is your inverse targeting. Dual targeting. Dual targeting, the name itself suggests something, two things are getting targeted here. So generally we prepare a dosage form by adding drug and excipient, and the drug will have the therapeutic effect. In dual targeting, drug as well as excipient will have the therapeutic effect. If you use the excipient which is showing the therapeutic effect along with the drug to enhance the therapeutic activity, this case we call it as a dual targeting. Simple. The dual targeting means while to prepare nanoparticles, I am using drug and excipients, and I'll prepare nanoparticles. The used drug has the therapeutic activity generally, but if the excipient is also having the therapeutic activity, that we call it as a dual targeting method, because you are targeting two things here, which is having the excipient is also having the therapeutic activity, hence we call it as dual, two things. The next one is double targeting. So double targeting, again we have something which is two here. Previously it is dual targeting, means same activity shown by two things, hence we call it as a dual. Here double targeting means in two way we are targeting. So one is sustaining the drug availability at the target site. We are targeting the drug at the target site, okay, but we are again sustaining the availability of drug to the target site. We call it as a temporal targeting. Temporal targeting means sustaining the availability of the drug to the at the targeting site. Next is spatial means making the drug to be available at the targeted site. So two types of targeting we are doing. One targeting is temporal, second is spatial, hence the name double targeting. What is temporal here? Temporal means making the drug to be available at the target site for a over a long period of time, sustaining the drug availability at the target site. Next, spatial, making the drug available at particular site. Two confusing terms here. What I mean to say is, let's say I have designed a sustained dose delivery. Now let's say the patient is suffering from liver cancer. I will target the drug towards the liver. This drug targeting we call it as a spatial targeting. So one method. Next, from where the drug is going to the liver, let's say the dosage form is going to the liver. So the availability of dosage form, the presence of dosage form in the blood will be adjusted in such a way that the drug will be, or the dosage form will be continuously available to the liver for a prolonged period of time. This we call it as a temporal. Temporal means sustaining the release, making the drug to available for a longer period of time. Spatial means at the space, at the site, the drug, making the drug to available. So this we call it as a dual targeting. We call it as a double targeting. Two types of targeting we are doing, hence we call it as a double targeting. Next one is physical targeting. What do you mean physical targeting? So we are using some physical means to target the drug, like temperature, or you can say pH. Okay, so the best example what I can give here is pH targeting. So we'll take a drug, we'll coat the drug with a polymer in such a way that when the polymer goes to particular pH region, then only it will release drug. Okay, that we call it as a physical targeting, or you can say magnetic also. So I will take a drug, I'll put magnetic particles in the drug, and I will coat that with a polymer. Now this is been converted into nanoparticle. I will inject this nanoparticle into the body. Now when I, let's say I want that particular particles to be concentrated here In such case, if I put external magnet here, because the drugs, the dosage form is moving in the blood circulation, when I place the magnet here, when the blood circulation comes here, okay, all the drug particles will get accumulated at a particular region due to the presence of external magnet. If I fine tune the vibrations of these magnetic particles here, okay, through external magnet, then those, they will vibrate and they will start releasing the drug. If I remove the magnet, they will not vibrate and they will stop releasing the drug. This is how I can control the drug release. So this is also a type of drug targeting. Here what you are doing, you are targeting the drug by the means of either temperature or means of pH or the means of magnet or anything, etc. We can use these things to target the drug, hence we call it as a physical targeting. The last and most important thing is active targeting. Here we will also see about ligand mediated targeting. Ligand mediated targeting, active targeting, or you can say ligand mediated targeting. So regarding this, I want to show you some videos, okay, about liposomes as well as about nanoparticles. How can we target? Just I will give the outline for this. The outline here is, take a drug, coat the drug with a polymer and put some active things, that is your, let's say, antibodies, or you can say something which is going to take this particle at a site of action. Because you are placing some active things here, what is that active things? Like antibodies are in. If I coat it with a drug and polymer with a antibody, this antibody is particularly directed towards, let's say, liver cancer. Okay, it has some antigen there. This is directed towards the liver cancer. This antibody will carry the nanoparticle till the liver cancer. Any cancer, you can take any cancer. Let's say breast cancer, we have antibody for the breast cancer. There is cancer, is the antigen, cancer cell has the antigens on it. This is a cancer cell, it has some antigen on it. Okay. Now we have a drug with antibody which is attached here. This will go and bind to the antigen, and this particular drug particle will be engulfed by the cell, that is through phagocytosis it will enter into the cell. After entering into the cells, that acidic environment of the cell will destroy the outer covering of, that is polymer of drug, and the drug will be released in the cell and the cell will be killed. So I will show the video of this. Try to check this one. So this video is a courtesy of Institute for Molecular Bioscience. Okay, I am just showing you this video for educational purpose. Assume these are the cancer cells. Okay, you can see here this particular thing. I try to round up. This one is your cancer cell. So the cell which you are seeing here, this one. Yeah, so this part is a cancer cell. This particular thing is, this is your antigen, this is your polymer which you are seeing here, and inside we have a drugs here. So this is a nanoparticle which is being coated with the antigen. Okay, now we will direct this antigen coated nanoparticle towards the breast cancer. Just check here, I will show you this video. Yeah, so we have, I told you, check here. These are the receptors on the cell of a cancer. These are the antibodies. These antibodies will try to sit on this receptor. Okay, now why they are sitting there? Because we are coated that nanoparticle with the antigens, or you can say our antibodies, which can go and sit on the receptor which is present on the cell of cancerous cell. So this nanoparticle is particularly directed towards there. Hence we call it as a active targeting. So we are making something to direct that, hence we call it as a active targeting. Check here. So when it sits there, when they binds there, that whole particle is engulfed into the cell. So it is been engulfed into the cell. Now see here, there will be a vesicle made by the cell. In that vesicle, I'll just stop here. What is happening here is cell is trying to make an vesicle here. Okay, it will cover that particle with some proteins. Okay, vesicle, try to create a vesicle, and this vesicle is directed towards the nucleus into the cell. Check here. So after making an vesicle, they will be directed towards the into the cell. Now when it goes into the cell, because the environment in the cell is acidic, this acidic environment, okay, particularly try to dissolve the outer, yeah, now it is again entering into the nucleus. Yeah, once it enter into the nucleus, because the environment of the nucleus is acidic, this acidic environment will try to degrade. Once the drug enters into the cell, see here, once that nanoparticle enter into the cell, because the environment is acidic, this acidic environment will dissolve the polymer which has been coated on the nanoparticle, and it will release the drug. See here, the red dots which you are seeing is a drug, and this drug will try to kill the cancer cells. You can clearly see here, only the cancer cell is being killed and other cells are intact. Only the cancer cell is being killed. This is how the target drug delivery will work. Again, I am mentioning here, you can clearly see only the cancer cell is being killed and other cells are intact. So this is how the target drug delivery will work. So this video is the courtesy of Cipla. I will just show you the working of liposomes, which is developed by Cipla here. So what this point is showing is, because your anti-cancer drug is cytotoxic, if you give this drug without selectivity or non-selectivity, it will cause toxicity for cardiac, that is cardiotoxicity, bone marrow toxicity, and also nephrotoxicity. These are the various things which can happen if you give the drug which is toxic, cytotoxic, and you are not targeting the drug. Now, generally, you can see here, if you give the normal drug, this drug will be distributed throughout the body. So throughout the body, drug is distributed. Now, if you target the drug has been targeted only at the particular place. Okay, so by targeting the drug at the particular place, what is thing you can do here is, to avoid the negative effects of the drug, you can lower the dose. If you lower the dose, which will lead to compromising of dosing, narrow therapeutic window, and poor efficacy of the drug, which in either case I don't want to happen. Instead of lowering the dose, along with the lowering the dose, I want to target the drug. To avoid the cytotoxicity, we can lower the dose. If you lower the dose, these are the three problems. So to avoid these problems, I can convert them into target drug delivery, that is liposomes. We'll try to see in the next part. See, now targeted drug delivery, by making the drug to be targeted drug delivery, we'll try to see what are the silent features of liposomes. Those are, liposomes are composed of natural lipids. These are composed of natural lipids, and they are biologically inert, biodegradable, and weakly immunogenic. And they are passive targeting. I told you, because these liposomes are made up of lipids, in the first part of our target drug delivery, what we studied there is, you can have the passive targeting with the help of lipid particles. That one example is here, liposomes. Next is possible to avoid RES, reticuloendothelial system. You can avoid the reticuloendothelial system, okay, because they are passively targeted towards spleen and liver by pegylation. By pegylation, you have liposomes here. By adding that pegylated group, this pegylated group will not make these liposomes to be concentrated in reticuloendothelial cells. Next is increased plasma circulation and increased half-life. active targeting can be achieved, reduced toxicity can be achieved, and enhanced efficiency can be achieved. These are the salient features of liposomes. Yeah, we will see the production of liposomes here. How can we create the liposomes? Okay, so what we can do here is liquid and a hydrophobic drug in organic solvent. So you have take an organic solvent here. Take an organic solvent in this. In this we have drugs and also lipids. So lipids plus drug plus organic solvent, keep in this round bottom flask, fix this flask to the rotatory evaporator. Now what happens, due to the heat, whatever the organic solvent is there, it will get evaporated. So it will get evaporated from here. Now finally we get only dry lipid film. So the after evaporation we will be left out with lipid and drug, not the solvent, organic solvent, because the organic solvent is been evaporated in this process. So this dry film, to this dry film if you add water or you can say buffer, this can be converted into liposomes. This is a simple method to create liposomes. So for that, make them hydration. By hydrating you can get the liposomes here. Okay, next, after by sonification you can achieve either single lamellar liposomes or multilamellar. Single lamellar, multilamellar means there will be, if it is like this, we call it as a single lamellar liposomes. Multilamellar, it will be like this. Okay, so through sonication, if you make the initially you will get multilaminar vesicles, MLVs. If you try to sonicate it for longer time, you will get unilamellar vesicles. Okay, ULVs. Now, what Cipla has developed, just see here. They developed the liposomes for two drugs. The two drugs are, one is amphotericin B and the other drugs is doxorubicin. Okay, we call it this as a fosome and this is oncodox PEG. Okay, two types of liposomes are there. This is the plain liso liposome, this is the pegylated PEG, pegylated liposome, which contains anti-cancer drug, that is doxorubicin. You can clearly see here what is happening. The lipid which you have taken is cholesterol. Cholesterol forms your liposomes, and we try to put PEG here. So we got it as pegylated, okay, oncodox PEG, pegylated, and inside we have drug here, that is your doxorubicin. This how this liposomes will look. Once we inject this liposome into the body, into the bloodstream, here. So see here, this is the cancer cell. You can see here, this is the cancer cell which I'll represent in yellow. This cancer cell has, see the blood wall cell of the cancer, near cancer cell, because they have more and more perfusion. More and more drug will be getting, not drug, liposomes will get accumulated into the cancer wall only. Why? Through enhanced permeation and retention effect. We call this as enhanced permeation retention effect. Because there is more permeation, more blood flow to the cancer cell group, and there will be more and more liposomes which are getting penetrated into the cancer cell, and there will be a retention of the liposomes into the cancer cell, because these liposomes are made up of lipid and cancer cell also has more lipid in it. So they will get retention there. So this we call it as a, through EPR effect, more and more drug will get accumulated into the cancer cell. So that is the first part of your doxorubicin. Second part we try to see about amphotericin B. Amphotericin B is a antifungal drug. If you give this antifungal drug in non-liposomal dosage form, it will cause multi-organ damage, it will cause irreversible kidney damage, hypotension, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, headache, okay, drowsiness, generalized weakness, etc. So these are the side effects. If you give this amphotericin B drug in non-liposomal form. Now, by converting them into liposomal form, okay, see this how it looks, fosome. So this fosome is a name given by the Cipla. Fosome is a name given by the Cipla to the liposome which contains your amphotericin B. Now, what it contains, you can see here, drug will be accumulated here in this region, okay, and we have cholesterol also here, which has been make up, okay. So we use the lipid as a cholesterol and we put the drug, you take lipid as a cholesterol, put the drug, put organic solvent, okay, shake them, you will get a thin layer of your lipid, then again hydrate, you will get this liposome. This is how we prepare this liposomes. When we inject, see here, when we inject this liposome amphotericin B into the blood, see in the previous one, because these liposomes are been tagged with the PEG, pegylated, these are not detected by macrophages. But in this case, the liposomes are not pegylated. So if you don't want that liposomes to be detected by immune system, then pegylate them. If you want them to be detected by immune system, in this case, we want that macrophage to eat that liposome, because ultimately wherever there is an infection, this macrophage will assemble there and release the drug there itself. Results. This has been first taken up by macrophages. What is happening here? You saw that it has been taken up by macrophages. These are the macrophages. These are the amphotericin B. This is the amphotericin B liposomes. These liposomes are taken up by the macrophages. Once the macrophages take that liposome, now this macrophages will try to move to the region of infection. Okay. See here, this macrophages slowly move to the region of infection. In this case, this particular patient is having infection in lungs. Okay, fungal infection in lungs. And by moving to the region of infection here, they will release the drug, amphotericin B drug, at the site of infection only. Due to this, what happens? The generalized, the side effects of amphotericin B can be reduced, and the drug is being targeted at the particular site where it is required by converting it into a liposomes. So this is how we can target the drug. There are many methods to target. I tried to simplify some of the methods here. Okay, I hope you understand. Thank you.